not want to miss. On Wednesday, May 11th, we're having our Wednesday night supper. The menu is in your order of worship. This is also your chance to RSVP, so please let us know if you will be attending so that we can make sure that we have plenty of food. Also, there are plenty of save the dates in your order of worship, if you'll take a look at that. Beginning on Memorial Day Sunday, May 29th, we're going to move to one service. This is an opportunity for us, just for about 7 weeks, just for summer, don't freak out. Just for a couple of months, we're going to be combined, we're going to be one church together, one worshiping body together for the summer months. So that will begin May 29th all the way through July 10th, so please mark your calendar and make sure you know that we will have one service at 10 a.m. starting at the end of May. Also, a slight little typo in this save the date. Dr. Byron Thomas, our district superintendent, will be here on June 26th, not July 3rd. And July 3rd, not 5th, will be a hymn sing. So just swap those two in the middle there, and we should be good to go. But it is a wonderful time. There are plenty of exciting things coming up that we get to celebrate, and we are so excited about that. But now let us turn our thoughts and our hearts to God as the choir calls us to worship. Methodist with the Apostles' Creed.
Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting.
To the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues of Damascus so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he was going along, approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they heard the voice, but saw no one. Saul got up from the ground and thought his eyes were open. He could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight and neither ate nor drank. This is the end of the first reading.
At this time, it is a joy and honor to bring our prayer requests before the Lord. This book is always right outside our sanctuary before the service. But if you have a prayer request that you do not want read aloud or shared online, you can take one of those blue cards in the chair in front of you and write a prayer request on the back of that. Those can go in the offering plates, and they will not be published, but they will be prayed over this week. Today we are praying with Doug and Susan Smith for their friend Darcy Gillery, who is undergoing chemo for breast cancer. Also for their friend Patsy Reagan, the mother of Chuck Reagan, who's recovering from neck surgery. We pray for their friends, the Gresham family, on the death of Tim Shelton. And we also pray for Chris Belbeck, Lindsay Price's mom, for a speedy recovery from surgery. We pray with Joel Christman. We often pray for his sister, Jenny Lewis, and for many years now. Earlier this week, she was put in palliative care, and unfortunately, last night, Jenny did pass away. So we are praying for Joel and his family as they grieve this loss. We are also continuing to pray for Cindy Brubaker, who is still fighting cancer. We pray with Kaylee Miller for the Staining family who lost their 24-year-old son last week. And we pray with Larry Reed, who had a fall last week, and when they went to get him examined, they found a brain tumor. So he was taken in for emergency surgery on Friday. He came through the surgery well. He is making improvements, and they are hoping that he will be able to go home. So we celebrate that he is making steady progress. We pray with Key and Brenda Ellis for Al Pope, who is in the hospital with medical concerns, and for Brenda and Richard Hudson for their neighbor and our member, John Hudson, who's healing from a serious infection in his body, but we celebrate that he is at home now recovering. If there are others on your prayer list, others that you wish to lift up, know that God hears you, and this is a perfect time to lift them up to the Lord. Let us pray together at this time. Holy and loving God, we come to you when we do not always have the words to say. We see our prayer list before us, and we know these people, we have been praying for them. There are new ones each day. Lord, they trouble us. We wish that our list could be short. We wish that our list could be all praises, and yet we find hope in you. That even when we experience death, we celebrate eternal life. That even when we experience an illness or an injury, we celebrate that you are near. Strengthening us. Lord, there are so many things going on in our lives and in the lives of those that we love. Help us to be a pillar of strength for each of them. Help us to be present in our prayers, in being with them, in being a shoulder to cry on, and in being your disciples who go into the world to care for one another and to make disciples of others. As we come to you this morning, we ask that you would hear our prayers and that you would teach us something new. We do long to be your disciples, and sometimes we're not always sure what that looks like. So we ask that you give us new eyes. We ask that you reveal new sight. We ask that you give us the wisdom and knowledge and the path forward to better serve you. And Lord, when we do not have the words, we give thanks that you have given us. generous God, we give thanks that you offer so much to us. It is with humble hearts that we return our love to you by giving you our tithes and offerings. We ask that you take these gifts, bless them, and use them in a way to further your kingdom here on earth. In your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Not speak today. Okay. Our second reading comes from Acts chapter 9, verses 10 through 20. And I've been asked before, why do we stand for some of the readings and not stand for others? Typically what you would do for a gospel reading of anything from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John would be to stand in honor of the gospel, because it is the story of Jesus, it is the words of Jesus, and we celebrate that. We still celebrate the rest of the scripture. We still believe that it is God-inspired. But we give just a little more oomph to the Gospels, because that is where Jesus is. Personally, I think it's fine to stand for either, and I don't think God gets offended when we don't stand. So most of the time we stand for the Gospel, which is right before the sermon. Today we're reading from Acts, so y'all are welcome to remain seated. Acts chapter 9, verses 10 through 20. Now there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias." He answered, "Here I am, Lord." The Lord said to him, "Get up and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment he is praying, and he has seen a vision, a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him, so that he might regain his sight. But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who invoke your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings and before the people of Israel. I myself will show them how much we must suffer for the sake of my name." So Ananias went and entered the house. He laid his hands on Saul and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on your way here, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes, and his sight was restored. Then he got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. For several days he was with the disciples in Damascus, and immediately he began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogue, saying, "He is the Son of God." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Today is the third Sunday of Easter, and we continue hearing stories of how life was different after Jesus' resurrection. We fast forward a little bit today to get a glimpse of how the disciples, often known now as the apostles, were spreading the good news of Jesus and gaining followers. There is an organization called The Way that looks something like the early church and encouraged people to follow the way, the truth, and the life of Jesus. Today's story, however, shows that we know church growth isn't always easy, and following Jesus comes with a certain set of risks. Many of us have heard of Paul, who is the author of many letters in the New Testament. We remember him as a strong example of following Christ and working hard to set an example before others. But he wasn't always such a model Christian. In earlier parts of Acts, we see him doing truly terrible things. Paul used to be known as Saul, and was famous for imprisoning and killing Christians. Now, most of us can't really fathom that. we're embarrassed about. Perhaps we can remember a time when our behavior was unkind or maybe even cruel towards someone else. There may be times when we have said things to intentionally hurt people. If we think back on it now, we would probably be horrified if someone wrote those words down or wrote about that incident in a book to be preserved for all eternity. We want to forget our mistakes and move past them, and to have them written down forever would be quite embarrassing. So let's take a look at Saul, since it is written down for all eternity. But if you look at his character, he honestly reminds me a bit of the Grinch. We know the Grinch from Dr. Seuss. He hated the Whos, and no one really understood why. Several of the more modern movies have come out attempting to give him a bit more of a backstory, since the original is only about 30 minutes and they want, you know, fully filmed. But the opportunity is there to give him a backstory to justify his behavior for why he would steal Christmas. We're never truly sure. Honestly, he may have just been a rotten person. He may have been someone that just didn't care until he had his revelation and his heart grew 3 sizes. When we look back at Saul, we recognize a similar story. Saul was Jewish and did not believe that the Messiah could be killed as easily as the man who had hung on the cross of Jesus. Saul felt that Christianity was going against his religion, and therefore he hated Christians. He hated those who were known as followers of the way. But he didn't just hate them. He intentionally worked against them. Seeing that they were imprisoned and he was working with the high priest, keeping in mind that this was the same group of fanatics who originally worked to have Jesus crucified, and made sure that he had permission to punish any followers. There are a lot of times throughout history, and even today, when people do really horrible things in the name of religion. And we don't like to talk about it because, I mean, it gives us a bad name when things are done in Christianity. We don't like to think about the possibility that we could ever be doing something wrong or something difficult in the name of our faith. And so it's a struggle to think about what has been done in the past, what these main characters in Scripture have done. And yet here we have Saul, upset that people are following the way, and upset that people saw things differently than he did. If we were to reach down, way, way, way deep down, we can probably relate to Saul on some level. Saul probably saw people differently and just didn't quite understand their belief in Jesus. We see people all the time with whom we disagree. And when we're in that situation, there's one of about 3 things that we can do. When we see someone with whom we disagree, we can ignore it and keep moving, recognizing that we have a difference of opinion, but we're going to respect our differences and move on. No need to even bring it up. Or we can engage with one another. We can have a conversation. We can try to learn from one another, hearing their story and sharing with them ours, and seeing if perhaps we have any common ground. Or we can get angry. We can take out our aggression on them. We can try to punish them for what they believe that is different from us. And this can look like a variety of different things. It may be leaving an angry comment on someone's Facebook post and explaining all the reasons why they're wrong. It may be making life more difficult for them by putting up barriers and restrictions in how they attempt to participate in the world. Or it may look like Saul, who went around having people arrested and killed because he did not like who they were following. because Jesus saw what was happening to his people, and he saw how Saul was treating them. And Jesus did something about it. Keep in mind here that Jesus has been resurrected and he has ascended. And yet he makes the time to come down, at least by his voice and by light, and he changes Saul's life forever. Jesus strikes him blind and tells him to go to Damascus and await further instructions. Here he sends his disciple Ananias to Saul in order to heal his sight and fulfill his vision that Saul had just had of this very thing happening. Saul has something like scales fall from his eyes. That's how it's described. I would imagine when I hear this, it's something like getting cataract surgery. For anyone who's had that, there's, you know, kind of this scaly thing preventing you from seeing clearly. And then when it is removed, your sight becomes better. Saul had the scales fall from his eyes, and then he could see. Not only can he see, but now he experiences the world differently and sees members of the way with new eyes. He becomes one of the biggest advocates for Christianity, and he goes on to be well-known and remembered throughout history. This is the kind of story that you want written down and told forever. It's a strange and unusual story, and yet someone who has been seen as the worst becomes someone who is seen as the best. How do we get here? I want you to think back to another story, a parallel story of Jesus and Peter after the resurrection. This story comes from John chapter 21, when we remember how Jesus cooked breakfast on the beach for his disciples. And then Peter took him aside and asked him, "Peter, do you love me?" "Of course I love you," Peter replied. So Jesus said, "Then feed my sheep." 3 times Jesus asked this, and 3 times Peter replied, "Of course I love you." The number 3 sticks in our mind because it was 3 times that Peter denied Jesus. The dawn before his crucifixion, before that rooster crowed. And here, 3 times, he's given an opportunity to reclaim Jesus and proclaim his love. So what do these stories have in common? It feels like totally opposite characters looking at Saul's conversion into Paul next to Simon's conversion into Peter. Paul couldn't stand Christians. Simon Peter was one of Jesus' closest friends and followers and disciples. Saul technically never saw Jesus that we're aware of. He appeared as a light and a voice road to Damascus. Peter knew Jesus very well. And yet what these two have in common is that Jesus called them both. Jesus saw something in each of them. A lowly fisherman on the Lake of Galilee and a passionate Jew fighting fiercely against Christians. Jesus saw them both as worthy. No matter what was going on in our lives, whether we love Jesus or hate him, whether we use our powers for good or for evil, we are still capable of being transformed. No matter what is going on in our lives, now or in the past, we are capable of being transformed. And once we've been transformed, we can be a witness. Peter had so much passion that he often spoke before he thought, and he jumped before he looked. He stumbled and he fell and he doubted and he questioned, but he was faithful to Jesus. Saul also had a great passion, and Jesus realized that he could use that. He knew how to turn that energy into something more positive. He just had to get his attention first. When Ananias approached Saul, it said something like scales fell from his eyes and he was more clearly. Jesus got his attention, and his life was never the same. Peter was asked three different times whether he loved Jesus, and three different times he had to answer. Jesus got his attention, and his life was never the same. How is Jesus working to get your attention today? What we learn from this is that we can be transformed no matter what our story is. God can use all of us to be a witness. No one is unworthy. Everyone is capable of being called and equipped to do God's work. Everyone can be a witness because everyone has been invited to the table and been offered forgiveness, grace, love. And we celebrate that the table is prepared before us even now. We celebrate that God is inviting us to break bread together, to be transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit, and to hear that we are called and we are equipped. We celebrate an open table, that this is not a Crossroads table, it's not a Methodist table, it is Lord's table. And so all are welcome to come and receive. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join it there.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, and broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it. Remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these guests of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, so that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. In just a moment, you will be invited to come up and to receive Holy Communion. We do have individual cups and bread so that you may take a piece and partake of it that way. You are welcome to leave your cup and your toothpick on the rail as you make your way back to your seat. And you're welcome to come and pray at the rail as long as you like. We have baskets at the end that are for collections for Good Samaritan. Those monies will be used for people in our community who are most in need. But we celebrate the chance to have a meal together. If you're not comfortable coming forward to receive, we do have the individually prepackaged communion in the back. If you just raise your hand, an usher will be happy to bring those to you, and you're welcome to partake. And receive the grace of God.
Thank you.
Continue to lift up her family in our prayers. As we go through